Alrighty, welcome back. Back to chapter 10. Getting a little deeper into chapter 10 now, and you're going to start to see how, that basic principle of Gestalt psychology kind of gets applied in a more general way, beyond perception and more towards, well, things that start to feel like social psychology. So let's get to it. So in this one, we're going to describe three people, describe the things that they did: Kohler's, Kafka, and, well, depending on how you want to say it, Lewin or Levine. Technically Levine, but he came to accept Lewin as a pronunciation as well. So I'll probably go with Lewin throughout this. These guys are kind of oddballs in a sense. So they certainly were oddballs in their time. I think they were taking some of these Gestalt ideas and bringing them into unknown territory. And they're not really how we think of social psychologists per se, but they're certainly laying the groundwork for social psychology. And in fact, in the lecture that follows Module 7C, we will be into social psychology proper. So this is sort of the middle ground between Gestalt and social psychology. What connects them? I want to remind you of this slide that I used last lecture. I was talking about, things like this, where this 3D cube seems to pop out at us. And I was saying how that went against a real, just sort of building things out of parts, that sort of reductionist approach to understanding, how the mind perceives things, for example. And I ended up saying it's not that. It's something much more like this, much more interactive, where the results of previous sensory processing have been stored in memory at some part, in some way. And now, as we sensorily process things very early on, as we start to get information from the world, our memory systems start to affect the way we process that information. So it's not just a bottom-up stream coming up, it's a much more interactive process that ultimately determines our phenomenology, what we experience. And so this figure, you're going to see variants of that. So when I talk about classic Gestalt, it's sensory processing, and then it's sort of meaning or memory at the top. You're going to see that basic framework can be applied in a number of different contexts, and this is the thread that's really going to connect everything, which is why I have this. You won't find this figure in the textbook, by the way. I just put it in with my lectures to try to show you this connection in a very explicit visual way as we go. So we had said, this was the original Gestalt thing, that it was about sampling from the environment, and this idea that higher level information is affecting the way we're doing that, affecting the way we're constructing our own realities. Yeah. Okay. So now let's start taking this a few steps. So, really interesting, Wolfgang Kohler. Oh, I should have had the umlaut on his. Oh, I feel bad to not have the umlaut up there. Kohler, you kind of see the dates there. And in fact, most of the work that he was doing was in the 19, 15, 1910, 1915 to the 1930s, which was a time of war. And Wolfgang, oddly, had went to this island to study apes, chimpanzees, and he got stranded there during World War I. So he was isolated. We all know what isolation feels like. He was isolated on an island with a bunch of monkeys. And while you might think that would be kind of maybe a, well, it's not so bad. It was a tropical island. It was nice and warm. And he was actually highly, highly productive. He found it a really interesting time. So what he started doing, he had access to all these captive apes. And what he would do, they would be in these big outdoor cages and such, and he gave them problem-solving tasks and he watched them. But as he did that, he was just kind of curious about their problem-solving abilities. To kind of, see what they could do, he would do some sort of, I won't call it nasty things to them. He would challenge them, let's say that. So what do we got here? We have a bunch of bananas here, and a chimpanzee that would really love to have those bananas, but the bananas are too high to reach. Now, the chimpanzee has other things around. And what he found is, this is kind of the depiction after the fact. What he found is that the monkey would kind of muck around for a while, would take some boxes and move some boxes and look up and think and sometimes sit in a corner and just stare and walk around. But then at some point, I'll come back to this. This is what I want to say. Something that Kohler's called insight happened. It is like the chimpanzee just, well, we always think of the light bulb going on, right? We have that bing, oh, we got it. That is Kohler's insight. In fact, Kohler's invented the light bulb. He didn't invent the light bulb, but that concept of the light bulb turning on, that was Kohler's. And that's what he said he could see happening with the chimpanzees. They would sit there, they would hum, they would haw, they would try to figure things out, and then they would suddenly seem like they had a moment of clarity, and their behavior would become very purposeful. And specifically, he would see things like this. They would start to take boxes, and they would pile them up underneath the bananas, one box over the other, until they could climb up on the boxes and reach the banana. And so in Kohler's point of view, or his opinion, this was like a gestalt kind of phenomenon that happened. So what he said is, yeah, early on, they maybe started trying to solve the problem in a very bottom-up way, just kind of using what's there and figuring stuff out. But what is this insight? Kohler says this is when they kind of grasp the gestalt of the situation, the gestalt, the sort of whole system that's in play. And when they really understand, okay, what do I have? A banana that's too high, and I have some boxes and I can step on them, that at some point, you know, that goal that they have in their mind, which Kohler's always thought was very important, feeds into the way they see all of the stuff around them. So once again, the kind of top. So we said meaning memory before. But for Kohler's, this is more like some goal, something they're trying to accomplish, suddenly feeds down and affects the way they think about the stuff that's in the room. And they start to assemble stuff informed by that goal. So once again, what we have here is not just a random trial and error kind of thing going on, but in Kohler's mind at least, a much more gestalt kind of thing going on, where literally higher level things like the goal state of the animal are affecting its phenomenology, it's the way it thinks about the lower level things, like how to put boxes together. And so again, this much more interactive kind of approach, where, you know, the goal state is affecting the way we look at the things that are around us. And especially if we start to think, oh, if I could climb on something, then I could get the bananas. Then we look around and say, what can I climb on? And I don't know if you do this. Should I show you behind the camera for a moment? But I will show you behind the camera for a moment. This is going to be kind of weird. So, by the way, I have this crash bang. I have this sort of semi-studio kind of set up here. I'm not using the umbrella light, but look at this box. All right, flip this around now. What is that box? I went hunting for that box for a long time. Why? Because I had a certain goal state. If you guys haven't learned this yet, it's really not smart to put your laptop below your face, because then you're looking down at it and two things happen. One, I'm going to pause this for a second, if I can. Okay, that was weird. Phone rang, but it's been handled. Maybe I edited it out. Maybe I didn't. Doesn't matter. Let me come back. All right, so I showed you everything. I was talking about the box. I went looking for that box quite a bit because it needs to be the right height. If you're looking down, the viewer can look up your nose, plus you're looking down, and if you have double chin issues going on, that really exacerbates them, and so you end up with like a whole bunch of chins. But if you can look up and straight, that's how we see ourselves in the mirror. That's how we think of ourselves. And so you really like to get your video camera at this line of sight of your face directly. I don't even know how well I'm doing this now. I can't see it. So at any rate, I went looking. I was one of Kohler's apes, right? I had the goal, and I realized, oh, I need to lift my computer up. And then what can I use to lift my computer up? Again, this problem solving, in order to successfully solve problems, you can't just perceive the world in a bottom-up way. You need to have higher levels informing the lower levels. Okay, so more of that gestalt kind of vibe. When we talk about Kohler's, he also approached this issue. We've talked about psychophysical parallelism before, and that idea that that when we talk about sort of cognitive acts, that there are biological acts, you know, brain changes that correspond to it, that maybe, you know, every thought has a brain change that kind of corresponds with it. So some parallelism between what's happening in the brain and what's happening in the mind. When Kohlers was thinking about this, he thought of it in a very kind of structural way. As we talk about it, he thought there were very specific parts of the brain that were responsible for very specific or were underlying very specific thoughts or experiences that we had. And so if you change the structure of the brain, you should change corresponding experiences. So he's pretty strong on that. So he did these studies with the Necker cube. Now if you know this Necker cube, if you look at it long enough, you can see it two ways. It's always hard to do this with people, but I'll try to get you to do it. So one way is I'm going to trace out a square. Look at the square I'm tracing out. Okay, that square, I would like you to bring that as close to you as possible. See that as the front of a cube, the closest side to you of a cube, and then the rest of the cube recedes down and backwards. So you should be able to see it like that. Now you should also be able to see it like this. I'm going to trace out a different cube. This one is now the closest to you. Trace that a few times. And this cube recedes backwards and to the right. Okay, so hopefully you can see one or the other. If you can't, try to keep one, whichever one, and stare and stare and stare and stare. And what you will usually find is that the cube will flip on you. Okay, the one that you see on the front, it'll suddenly change, and you'll see that other side on the front. Kohlers thought this was because the brain region responsible for seeing it a certain way gets sort of tired. It has a what we call a refractory period, so it could get it could lose its ability to hold on to that perception. So he thought, as that part of the brain literally lost its ability to hold it, then another part of the brain that saw it the other way would take over, so to speak. And that's why it flips on you, because you're actually kind of exhausting one part of the brain that's holding on to a certain phenomenal experience. But that part tires, and then you flip to another phenomenal experience of the cube. So he thought this was very serious. Now the book goes on, and he'll give you details about this, that a number of people did studies that they said rules this out, shows it's wrong, and everybody accepted those studies. However, it turns out that as time went on, new research started to suggest that some of Kohler's ideas here might actually be accurate. So the kind of cool part of this story that I want you to get from the history of psychology is this idea that psychology can be so sort of fad-like. And the way this is described in the book is that the people who provided the evidence against this view, the evidence wasn't really all that strong. However, the community just accepted it. Maybe because of who they were, or for whatever reason, they didn't like Kohler's idea to begin with, but there was widespread acceptance that this view had been falsified. And the most of the crew went on as though that's true. And so that can happen in the sciences. It is a social construction. Science is a social construction. So I want to echo all the way back to, you know, the very first lectures here. And so if enough people, enough important people say, yeah, we've disproved that, then that can become the view of the science. That can literally become the new sort of paradigm that everyone believes, or not necessarily the new paradigm, but they're unwilling to move to a new paradigm, perhaps. So just to highlight that power when you read that part of the textbook, think about it that way, the power of these people to kind of determine what we even continue to investigate or not. That's kind of cool. Okay. This little thing in the corner, just to let you know, is the idea that Kohler's kind of laid out when he was talking about this. Well, eventually we created these things called artificial neural networks, and they're meant to be brain-like processing things, machine intelligence kinds of things. I'm not going to give you a whole lot of detail, but the interesting thing is, as they built these things and use them to account for various phenomenon, The principle that Kohler's described is one they built into these, and when you do, it does a better job accounting for data. So this was already like 1990s when neural networks like this were starting to be played with. And so from that period in between, everybody kind of said, ah, Kohler's has been shown to be wrong. And then since then, we're like, I don't know, maybe not. Something to think about. All right. That's Kohler's. Let's move to Kafka. We're just going to say a few things about Kafka, not a whole lot, but we have to say something about Kafka because one of the things you're learning in this course is one way to gain prominence in a field is to write a very good textbook, one that becomes influential, because then through that textbook, you are almost sort of defining the field and introducing it to a bunch of new scientists who now see you as the one that introduced this to them. So Kafka wrote Principles of Gestalt Psychology, which the textbook describes as the Bible of Gestalt Psychology. People use that analogy a little too freely sometimes, I think. But this was the textbook that defined Gestalt psychology, and then every new Gestalt psychologist read that and learned about Gestalt psychology from Kafka. So he became a very important figure for that reason. As far as his own ideas, rather than being sort of an author of the total area, he was really known for drawing this distinction, and it's going to be another sort of different level systems. So again, the Gestalt ideas, there's this interacting system of different levels. So he talked about things like the following. He said the relevant environment. So does the let me start with this. Does the environment affect you? Do things out in the environment have an effect on you? Kafka would say, well, that depends. Which environment do you mean? A person's geographic environment or its behavioral environment? The geographic environment is the environment you are in. It's what is really there and all around you. However, Kafka argued that we don't perceive everything that is around us all the time. We just can't. We pick certain parts of our environment that are relevant. Those are the parts of the environment that we're kind of attending to. And he called that our behavioral environment, those parts of the environment that are important to us. So right now, the only part of your environment that's important to you is me. Oh, if that were true. No, not really. But I am a major, this lecture hopefully is one major part of your environment that is something you're attending to. There, you may be trying to attend to two or three other things at the same time, which you shouldn't because you won't learn very well, but you may. So anything that's sort of impinging on your attention, anything that you're sort of sampling in the environment is part of your behavioral environment. Things in that environment can affect you and determine your behavior, and they can also define your phenomenal world. That's the part of the environment that you are experiencing, that you are part of. The geographic environment will have a whole bunch of parts of it that you're not really attending to and is not part of your experience at this time. Only when parts of the geographic environment enter your behavioral environment, can those parts affect you. Okay, so I think this idea alone is kind of interesting. But I think what I really want to highlight, especially as we move towards Lewin, is this idea of now he's thinking of a human and the context around a human. So we've talked about things like perceiving input and memory being the sort of the higher level thing that affects the way we perceive input. But now we're going to start to say, here's a person, and the higher level thing is the environment with that the person is within, and that the environment that you find yourself in affects the way you behave within it. So again, it's a bigger, higher level influence on something smaller than itself, an individual within that environment. Okay, and so Kafka started to talk about it in the ways I described, but we're going to see more of that now as we move to Lewin. Okay, here's the other thing I want to hit for Kafka. So let's put that aside for a sec, human versus environment. Kafka also talked a lot about constancies and how, and this is sort of related to his sort of phenomenal experience of the environment versus what it really is. So let's look with shape constancy first of all. And you'd say, let's say there's a door in the environment. And you see that door open. Maybe someone's going to walk through. For us, it seems as though this door is the same door as that door. Whoops, sorry. This one's the same one as this one, is the same one as this one. It's a single door that opens, right? It seems like its shape is constant. Its shape is not constant, in fact. If you just look at the angles on these pictures as you do things, you know, this is a proper rectangle, but this is now some sort of polygon, where these are not all 90 degree angles, and especially here, right, we have a tight angle here and a larger angle there, and so really this is not a rectangle at all anymore. And in reality, if we actually paid attention to its actual shape, its shape changes as the door opens. We don't phenomenally experience it that way, and part of Kafka's story is, wow, if the world kept changing on us all the time, it would be overwhelming and scary and freaky. But our brain kind of, even though things are changing at a low level, these higher level parts of the brain, the ones that know about the world and know that solid things like doors do not actually change their size, it is able to kind of undo what's happening at your eyeball, it is changing size, but let you kind of see it as being constant and in fact just opening. So in our mind, we think the shape of the door hasn't changed, it has just opened, despite the fact that on our eyeball the shape has changed, but our brain is able to kind of undo that. Same with size, right? So when we see these, let's say, garbage cans, to us it looks like these are the same size. They're not the same size, of course. They're getting smaller and smaller. If you just take a ruler and measure these, you'll find it's smaller and smaller and smaller. But because of the receding of distance, rather than accept the fact that it's smaller, our brain again says, things further away look smaller than they are, but it actually perceives this as having a constant size and just a varying distance. This is an example where the size actually doesn't change, and you see how ridiculous, you know, that looks to us. It either looks like this is huge, this one has either gotten really huge, or it just doesn't seem to fit the background at all, which is really what the phenomenal experience I'm getting. Yeah. Okay, this can get really kind of crazy, by the way. This is one of my favorites. So this says A, I think, and this says B. The important part of this figure is those two colors, the color of this square and the color of that square, are in fact identical. If you can just, you know, create something where you just cut out a little tiny circle and you put that little circle over those two things, you'll see that they look the same. They don't look the same here, right? Because it looks like these black and whites are all the same. So even these white squares, we kind of phenomenally perceive them all as the same color white, but they're not, of course, because there's this shadow that we see, right? And a shadow darkens something. But again, our mind assumes, yeah, shadows darken things, but we've seen checkerboards before and they're always the same color white. And so this is white with just a shadow over it. And that's sort of how this is viewed, as white with just a shadow over it. It doesn't ever seem to get that same color darkness that there is in that back one, even though it is in fact that. So all of this, again, to say there are these low-level perceptual things happening at the level of our eyeball that, in the case of constancy, if that was what fed our phenomenology, what we actually saw, we would see a constantly changing world. Every time a cloud went over, all the colors would change in the world. Every time a door opens, every time, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But our brain compensates for that. And it does so because it sees the world as a complex system, and it kind of models that complex system. And again, that's the kind of gestalt idea. This model of the complex system, where knowledge about the higher level features of the world, the fact that doors don't change shape when they open, literally affects the way we see the world, affects those lower level perceptions. Okay, I feel like I'm saying that a few times. So, but anyway, just to say, Kafka was big on these constancies and introducing those. Okay, so now this gets us to Lewin. Lewin, he was interested in electronic engineering. So he talked about things like fields, and in electronic engineering, they'll talk about fields, which are again systems. An electric field comes about when a system of well, when a system is constructed, where electricity runs through a system in a certain way. And so he knew that, and he talked about field theory. That was his approach to things. But really, it's very much in line with everything we just said. So very similar to Kafka. Kafka talked about, the geographic environment and the behavioral environment. Lewin really focused on what Kafka would call the behavioral environment. And so he called this a person's life space. So he started to expand this a little bit more, where a life space consists of the totality of facts that determine the behavior of an individual at a certain moment, right? From Kafka, we know that can only be the behavioral environment, because that's the part that influences the behavior of an individual. So this life space, L, represents the totality of possible events. The life space includes the person and the environment, which leads to this following formula. So the behavior of somebody is a function of the person and the environment within which they are. Again, just a fancy way of saying that environment, that higher level thing of the environment, affects the behavior of the person. And if we really want to understand the behavior of the person, we have to take that higher level thing into account. If not, we're not going to have a complete understanding of their behavior. Okay. So again, another sort of systems kind of approach. Now, just to unpack that a little bit more. Yeah. So now we have environment and person, but it's the same connecting string, right, that we're talking about all through here. Now, this just is a way to kind of I think of Lewin's ideas a little more specifically. So he said here, imagine this is a depiction of a life space, and he would depict things this way. So this is a life space for a person P. So there's the person over here, person P. And that person P is I think he said he was a junior in the book. So he starts out as a junior, and this is that person P kind of looking at the life that lies ahead of them. A life where eventually he wants to get to some goal, potentially a job of some sort. But in order to reach that goal, he has these events on his horizon. So he has to complete his senior year. He has to go to graduate school. Oops, sorry. He has to go to graduate school. He has to practice if this is like a clinical approach, I guess. So they would be doing clinical practice and shadowing and that kind of stuff. And then he might emerge as a clinical psychologist, which is his goal all along. And so the idea is these are the things that are in the person's mind. This is sort of what's in their world. And so it's not constrained. The real difference with Kafka is Kafka was really talking about sort of what's around you right now. But Lewin is saying your life space includes things like future events. It's kind of the environment you create for yourself that includes current circumstances, but also, I mean, this is a very forward-looking life space we have here, but could also include past experiences. So we could have some things over here too. But yeah, this notion that this is the world the person kind of functions within, and anything that enters their life space, anything that becomes sort of on their map of things they think about and do, those things now have the ability to affect their behavior. Anything in the life space can affect that person's behavior. And so again, we have this life space now that partly defines how we behave in any given situation. This, by the way, this egg is what he calls the foreign hull that separates the things that are on your mind and that are part of your life space from the things that just aren't. And so there may be some things you just never think about, worry about, don't come into your mind one way or another, and don't affect your behavior because they're outside of your life space, right? All right. And so I mean, we said Lewin. This is actually a student of Lewin's, Bluma Zygarnik. She's a Russian psychologist. She, he, I'm not sure. I'm sorry. I should know. I just know her. I just know him. It is Zygarnik. We know it is the Zygarnik effect. And so I'm now completely puzzled. Somebody can find out a little bit more maybe about Bluma and let us know. Or maybe I will. But this is kind of cool, and it allows me to end with a little bit of advice for you guys. So I'm just going to go through this. When Lewin talked about life space and working your way through the life space, he often talked about these tensions almost in a Freudian sense, but without all the sexuality and all that. But he thought there could be tensions, like the desire to get that goal that move you through the life space in certain ways. These tensions could be motivators. And that's what Zagarnik really kind of picked up on. So apparently, I think this is kind of interesting, that they noticed while they were at a restaurant that the wait staff were able to keep track of all these complex orders and unpaid bills until the meals were paid for. At that point, they didn't have to worry about them anymore, right? So it's kind of if you're Lewin, these things are in your life space, while they're still in your future. Oh, I have to make sure I get the right meals to the right people. I have to make sure I get the money from those people. But once you have done giving the right meals to the right people, now you no longer are thinking about who gets what. So it leaves your life space. And once they pay their bills, that leaves your life space. And so now you're not thinking about it and you're not able to recall that information, but you were while it was still sort of active. And so they came up with this idea and did a bunch of experiments that are very cool. You can hear about some of the experiments. The basic idea is just this. They would bring people into a lab, they would give them some tasks, a fair decent number of tasks, let's just say 16. I'll pick 16. But some of them they would interrupt before the person was able to finish them, and some of them they wouldn't. They would allow them to complete the task. And then a little bit later, they asked the people what tasks they remember. Tell me the tasks you remember. The ones the people remembered were the ones that they were not allowed to complete. So this is why I called it the power of unfinished business, or the tension, because that's the idea that this is, the classic Zeigarnik, at least, explanation that there's this cognitive tension that stems from unfinished tasks. When you complete something, you kind of relax, ah, it's done. But until then, you have this tension that sort of pushes you to complete it. And if something gets in the way of you completing it, now it's unfinished business. And you're driven to kind of get back to it and complete it. So that's where the motivation comes in for you to go back and kind of complete that task. Now, this can have some power. If you this is kind of cool. You can harness this Zagarnik effect to your benefit. For example, you can use it to help you if you were, oh, I don't know, say learning online. Just like this. We can give you some following tips. So this is a nice example of applied psychology, and one that could help you. So let's just do these tips. And they come from, by the way, this website. Why is the Zagarnik effect? What is it, and how to use it to stop procrastinating? All right, major problem with online learning. And there's the actual website if you want to go get more information from it. But let me just give you the highlights. Here's the recommendations. Just do one thing. So with procrastination, the problem is not starting, okay? And you keep putting off starting and putting off starting, putting off starting. But once you make that first step, once you begin doing what you need to do to accomplish some goal, then even if you don't complete it then, but the moment you start it, it's unfinished business. Right? The moment you begin, it's unfinished business. And so you're going to want closure at that time. And so if once you start it, you've got that motivational force, and that will push you back to complete it. So many people, when they procrastinate, they just don't ever start. And the first advice is just start. Just do something. That's step one. Now you've started doing something. Let's say study, let's say reading. Oh, let's say watching lectures. At some point, you're going to stop doing something. So here's a real counterintuitive bit of advice. Don't come to a nice place to stop. Don't wait till you're at a nice place. Oh, okay, we've just finished that chapter. I've just done this, and I've done the M2 on it, so I'm going to stop. If you stop when everything feels complete and closed, now you have to go back to here and get started again. But if you leave it not quite finished, whatever it was you were doing. So you read most of the chapter, but don't read the whole chapter. Don't finish the chapter. Leave a couple of pages because that's going to push you to come back and read those pages. And then when you do that, read those pages, read the next three or four in the next chapter. Don't stop after you've finished a chapter. Read two or three into the next one. Now it's unfinished business and it will pull you back. Okay. And finally, here we are. This one's kind of fun too. I like this. Set goals and keep them a secret. So, we get this little dopamine hit when we tell people about our goals, but that's not a good thing because it's kind of like accomplishing. It's like a mini accomplishment. Oh, look, I said out loud, I'm going to cut back on my potato chip eating. There, I said it out loud, and when you say it out loud, it feels like you've done something, which actually gives you this false sense of accomplishment, like you have actually done something, which makes it feel kind of complete, not an open book, and makes it harder for you to actually follow through. So make the goals, tell them to yourself, don't say them out loud, keep them unfinished business. So that's the kind of funny advice that comes from the whole Zagarnik effect. The more you can, if there's something you want to keep coming back to, then make sure it's unfinished business all the time. Don't ever kind of come to a nice closure around it. Kind of weird. All right. There we go. That's it for the middle of chapter 10. We're now going to finish up chapter 10 in lecture module 7C. And that one will really, I'm going to do a bit of a quick hit of about four social psychologists. You know all this research and data very well. These are the greatest hits of social psychology and the greatest hits of psychology. So we won't have to spend too much time talking about each of the studies per se, but I just want to more draw that thread that goes from the Gestalt psychology all the way to social psychology so that you can sort of see that. But I hope you see that already. There's a lot of, environment and one's social. We haven't really got the social world so much, but one's world and the fact that one's world has an influence on them. And it's really that step to the social world that we're taking next. Okay, cool. Excellent. See you there.